Bruno van Vijveen is my name, and I direct the Transnational NGO Initiative here at the Moyne Institute. And I'm glad to say I have many of our team members here. So Fari, who is taking us, our GA, and there's Daniela, one of our volunteers, and there's Danielle, one of our to-be volunteers, and there's Shreya, our program manager. She's an alum of Maxwell. And have I gotten everything? And Mirja Han, who hopefully will do some work with us. So thank you all for coming. As you know, we focus on the role, the governance, leadership, and effectiveness of transnational NGOs in that role in global governance, if you will. And as part of our commitment to education in the school, we offer occasional speakers. Sometimes they're practitioners. Today, we have an academic with us, Christopher Pallas. And Professor Christopher Pallas is assistant professor in conflict management at the Kennseaw State University, which is in the suburbs of Atlanta, Georgia. And Professor Pallas' work is actually not directly so much on conflict management, so I hope he didn't come for that. As it says in the title, his talk is on undemocratic activism, transnational civil society, the World Bank, and the democratization of global governance. So Professor Pallas is interested in power imbalances within global governance and in issues of accountability, legitimacy, and representation. In this talk, he will talk about how CSOs, civil society organizations, and actors have engaged in influencing of the World Bank, and how power differentials between and among CSOs, civil society organizations, can play a role. Professor Pallas is also interested in the political economy of NGOs, international NGOs. What are their resource dependencies? What are their financial what are the financial constraints that they work on, and how does that influence the acting by advocacy NGOs? He holds a PhD from the London School of Economics, a very renowned school, and he was a member of the Center for Civil Society, which is quite well known for its research. So just to say finally that I'm really looking forward to this talk, because a long time ago I worked at the World Bank. My main role was to be kind of a bridge between civil society and World Bank officials, if you will, in our work. So I've been on both ends of the spectrum, and I'm really looking forward to hear what you have to say about it. So.
Thank you very much. First, let me say thank you very much for inviting me. It's really a pleasure to be here. I have used research generated in the Transnational NGO Initiative actually quite frequently in my research, and I also really appreciate the ways that the Transnational NGO Initiative operates on both sides of the border between practitioners and academics, and I think in particular really can bring a really valuable perspective to the academic research, because you really are connected to what's happening on the ground. And so. I think that's part of what's made the research so valuable. So I really appreciate the opportunity to speak here. So thank you. Undemocratic activism, transnational civil society, the World Bank, and the democratization of global governance. Before I launch into this, let me tell you a little bit about how I got to this topic. So I come to academia out of a light practitioner background. I spent 4 years after my undergraduate working with a faith-based organization called InterVarsity Christian Fellowship, working out in the Midwest, but getting to see some of how grassroots NGO work looks like. And then after my master's, I spent 2.5 years as an NGO advisor in the US Peace Corps, working in Togo and West Africa. And in particular, the time that I spent in Togo motivated me to consider questions of representation, particularly in the making of global policies. I arrived in Togo, like many people in the development field, with a lot of solutions in mind and a very top-down approach to development, and was quickly disillusioned by many of the things that I saw in the field, lost a lot of my love for kind of this top-down development, but at the same time developed a really great passion for seeing local people empowered, because the people that I worked in Togo were hugely knowledgeable about the problems that were facing them, Oftentimes very creative and highly motivated to solve those problems. And the experiences that I had in Togo and the conversations that I had with people there really led me to reflect a lot about why is it that these sorts of local voices aren't better represented in the sorts of policies that are impacting them. And so when I went to do my PhD at the LSE, this was the thing that I wanted to look at, is basically how is global policymaking occurring and which voices are being represented in global policymaking? Why doesn't global policymaking yield kind of better policies or policies that are better for people at this grassroots developing country level? So this is research that I initially began when I was a doctoral student that ultimately culminated in a book that was published with Palgrave on transnational civil society and the World Bank investigating civil society's capacity to democratize global governance. I may have gotten a preposition or two wrong in that title. Yeah, you go through so many iterations. Culminated in a book with Palgrave and then a lot of follow-on research. And I'll allude to some of the follow-on research as well as I'm doing this talk. And we can discuss some of that more during Q&A, perhaps, if there's interest. So here we are, transnational civil society, the World Bank, the democratization of global governance. To give you just a sense of where we're going to be going over the next 45 minutes or so, I'm going to start with some background. I know that this is that many of you all are studying transnational NGOs or civil society, but I want to make sure that we're all on the same page. So we'll start with some background. What are transnational civil society organizations? Why are they important? We'll talk about the state of the field, the previous research. What is it that we know and don't know about these organizations and global governance? Then we'll talk specifically about my research at the World Bank and the findings from that, how that research was approached and the findings from that research, and then some of my policy prescriptions based on that research. So to begin, background, transnational civil society organizations. So I use the term civil society organization rather than the slightly more popular NGO, in part because I find that sometimes when people talk about NGOs, they exclude volunteer organizations, slightly less well-organized organizations, and especially faith-based organizations, because sometimes they don't meet the sort of typical understanding of a professional NGO. And I like to see those organizations included in my research. But in general, we're talking about non-governmental, not-for-profit actors that are either operating across state boundaries or are connected to boundary-spanning networks of other CSOs. So you might think of, say, Oxfam UK doing work in Sri Lanka, but you also might think of the Sri Lankan NGO that has become tied into a network of international labor activists because of their connection with Oxfam. So you can think of Population Services International based in the US, but doing family planning and HIV/AIDS prevention work all over the world. Or you can think of, say, the Center for Community Development Initiatives, which is an NGO in Vietnam that does HIV/AIDS work, that is linked into a lot of global HIV/AIDS advocacy. So it's really kind of an all-encompassing term here. So it can consist of these professional NGOs, but also voluntary organizations, faith groups, et cetera, and we've got some examples here at the bottom. So the importance of transnational civil society organizations. I mean, TCSOs are important actors in real empirical terms. TCSOs facilitate direct citizen input. I think about the things that I get in my email, right? So I get email from Food Democracy Now. They do work on agricultural policy. And when I get an email from them, I no longer have to wait until the next election cycle to harangue my congressional representative about agricultural policy. They send me an email. They tell me what's being debated on the floor in Congress, in the House of Representatives or in the Senate, what the bill is under consideration, their take on it. They give me the information. They give me some draft language, which I can modify. And they give me an email address to send it off to the people who are going to be influential, whether they're in the Department of Agriculture or the Department of the Interior or my elected representatives. And so the organizations like this, they facilitate direct citizen input. At the same time, they aggregate citizen voices, because if I just write to the Department of Agriculture on my own, might not have a lot of impact. But if 10,000 people write to the Department of Agriculture, somebody might listen. So there's a collective action problem that civil society organizations are solving. So there's direct citizen input, and then there's also the aggregation or the coordination of citizen voices. At the same time, there is empirical evidence that civil society organizations have an impact. And I want to stress to you that one of the things that I find striking in my research is that these two elements of significance is not always linked with this piece of significance. I think people tend to draw a causal link because they're correlated. Civil society organizations brought lots of voices to the table, and they saw policy change. The policy change must have been because they brought lots of voices to the table. It's not always the case, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. So I have this as kind of a separate piece of importance here. But basically, we know that transnational civil society organizations influence policy, and we can come up with any number of cases. If you're familiar with, say, the Jubilee campaign for debt relief, brought about very real debt reduction for many developing countries. The international campaign to ban landmines is a classic example. I mean, there's a massive new international treaty that results from citizen activism. You can think of, say, Amnesty International's work in promulgating new human rights norms and basically new agreements that are instituted at the UN level regarding disappeared persons and political prisoners and things like that. So we know that these organizations have real impact. And then in part because of this impact, TCSOs are perceived as a challenge to state authority. Traditionally, when we think about the international realm, we think of states as the key actors and states as being the holders of power. But civil society organizations, when they do something like influence a treaty on landmines, people say, well, you know, that used to be the sole domain of states, and now it seems like there's another actor involved. And so they constitute a potential challenge to state power, usually via this promulgation and enforcing of norms. So these are reasons why these are actors that are worth discussing, worth thinking about. So at the same time, when we think about global governance, there's a democratic deficit. And you'll see these two pieces, they fit together quite closely. So on the one hand, we have civil society organizations bringing new voices to the table and having new impact. And on the other hand, we've got global governance institutions that we think of as being generally fairly closed and having only a very limited number of voices involved. So in particular, if you think about, say, like the United Nations, sure, at the General Assembly level, every country gets one vote. But for many of the key decisions, things have to go to the Security Council, where the five permanent members, just five countries, really dominate the decision-making process. And so it's not a particularly democratic institution. Or you think of, say, the World Bank or the IMF, where the wealthiest countries have a disproportionate role in the voting, and where the board only consists of a very limited number of countries. I mean, you think of, I don't know how familiar you are with these institutions, but at the World Bank, I'm not sure, the World Bank has 25 executive directors now. It used to be 24, I think it's 25 now, they added one. The distribution of countries is allocated based on shares in the bank. And the United States gets its own executive director because we've got kind of the largest share in the bank. And so we have kind of one person who's dedicated just for speaking for the United States. There are 23 countries in sub-Saharan Africa that share an executive director. And that person sits at the table and has to represent 23 voices. So these are the sorts of kind of disequilibria that we find in global governance institutions. The decision-making is often very non-transparent. It's not like what happens at the state level where you have parliamentary politics where there are usually public votes and clear records of what's going on. Oftentimes, the organizations involved and how they make decisions are very opaque, oftentimes very technocratic, sometimes very deliberately closed. And then because of that, the organizations and the leaders involved tend to have limited accountability. If you don't know who is responsible for the decision, how can you punish them for making a decision that you didn't like? So these are ways in which international organizations tend to be undemocratic. At the same time, there are some other systemic issues. Stakeholder input tends to be intermediated by states. So even though you may live in a democratic country, so I'll take the United States for an example, it's not always clear that the people who are working on behalf of the United States in international policymaking are actually representing the majority of citizens. So you think about the discussions that are going on right now with the new Trans-Pacific trade deal, and the debate as to whether or not that trade deal actually represents the interests of the majority of citizens, or more a group of economic elite, or big businesses, or certain sectors within the government, and it's totally unclear. So citizen input tends to be intermediated by states, and there sometimes is a connection that's lost there. So that's an additional issue. And then in part because of these disequilibria, there's a concern that the policies that ultimately do come out of global governance institutions tend to benefit some states more than others. The classic example of this is structural adjustment lending, where the World Bank and IMF mandated certain policy changes from developing countries that were perceived to be advantageous to northern businesses and northern economic interests at the expense of those countries. Another great example is TRIPS, which is an intellectual property rights agreement that in its initial form would have banned the production and sale of generic HIV/AIDS drugs. It was really perceived as a travesty when it came out. There are any number of other examples. So there are all sorts of problems with democracy or the lack of democracy in global governance. So hopefully you see how these pieces fit together, that transnational civil society is going to bring citizen voices to the table. They can bring to the table the voices that haven't been heard before. They're going to open up these processes. So yeah, they're going to represent grassroots stakeholders. They're going to speak on behalf of people like developing country citizens who would otherwise be marginalized, who are excluded because the structures aren't set up in their favor right now. They can monitor the behavior of actors. They can get inside these technocratic or get information out of these technocratic institutions and expose it to the general public. And then through that process, they can start to hold policymakers accountable for the things that they're doing. That's the idea. That's the hope. And this is why people get excited about transnational civil society, particularly when they think about transnational civil society and global governance. And this is, as I was saying, coming out of my time in West Africa, this is the thing that drew me to the field. But what I discovered was that there are some problems with these sort of grand hopes. So one problem is that the transnational civil society organizations were largely based in the global north. And particularly coming out of development studies research, there are all sorts of problems that happen when you have NGOs based in the United States or Europe or other wealthy countries getting involved in the politics and policies of developing countries. There's this idea of, in particular, of moral hazard, where you have people getting involved in situations for which they do not bear the consequences of their own actions. So if I oppose your new power plant because I think it's bad for the environment, I don't have to deal with the lack of electricity. So there are issues that happen there. There are also a bunch of questions that were being raised, particularly in the development studies literature, about transnational civil society organization representativity and responsiveness. A lot of these questions were raised in sort of the in-country project level context when organizations were working on administering a particular project, like an education project in Nigeria, that sort of thing. But I thought, you know, I wonder if these issues scale up to the global realm. And what I felt like was that when I reviewed the data, most of the claims that civil society was going to be democratizing global governance either were highly kind of normative or predictive, and they came a lot out of the political science literature. These are things that we hope will happen, that we think are going to happen, but they hadn't been proven yet. Or where they did have evidence, the evidence tended to be of a highly selective sort, in that a lot of the evidence basically comes from practitioner accounts. And so you have academics that are curating or aggregating practitioner accounts, especially into edited volumes, and there are at least a half dozen of them, that are influential and well-cited in the field. But while the accounts have lots of very rich detail in them, they're very interesting accounts and very useful accounts, you can't really say that they are, in fact, neutral or objective accounts, because very few people are incentivized to write bad things about their own organizations. So these were some concerns that I had coming into the field. So these things launched me into research on this topic. And I chose the World Bank in particular because the bank has actually been very heavily lobbied by transnational civil society organizations. And so I thought if there was one place where I would be able to see what sort of impacts these organizations were having, it would be at the bank. Right. Let me just actually pause there. Any questions so far? Yes. Yes.
Is there not perhaps an instrumental benefit to them being based in the global north? Do they not have, because of their status and their origins, privileged access that we can make use of?
Absolutely. This is exactly one of the questions that we'll discuss later. So the question is, there's an advantage, perhaps, because perhaps you have greater power, greater resources. And so then the question becomes, on whose behalf do you use that power. So it's not necessarily wrong to have representatives. It's not necessarily wrong to say, it's not necessarily problematic that, for instance, in the United States, that most of the, half of the people sitting in the Senate have a personal worth of over $1 million. Maybe that's part of what allowed them to run for office and, you know, they cultivate the free time, become interested in the issues, et cetera, as long as they're actually representing their constituents. Absolutely. And this is one of the things that we'll talk about with civil society organizations. Yes?
I don't know if you're going to come to this later, but mm-hmm. just looking at stuff, wondering, would you be talking about whether or not these people who have privileged access, making themselves available as the medium instead of becoming the voice of the people they're seeking to represent? So instead of the South being represented by the Global North, could the Global North just be a platform that the South uses to reach the people who can't really hear them?
Absolutely. Yeah, and we will absolutely return to this when we talk about policy solutions, because you and I are thinking similarly about that. All right. So previous research, we'll go through this just in a couple slides here. So what we can demonstrate empirically, as I was saying earlier, is first that transnational civil society organizations have power. You can go and talk to people at the World Bank and ask them, why did you make this decision? And they will say, we were lobbied very heavily, or somebody presented us with new data, and they came from the civil society sector, and we did something different because of what they said to us. And so we both policymakers and the civil society organizations credit the organizations with these impacts. We know that civil society organizations can monitor and promote transparency. They definitely do manage to, Amnesty International manages to get the names of political prisoners out of repressive countries and and share those with the general public. We know that organizations are able to do this. And that civil society organizations are able to promote global norms. We know that they do indeed help cultivate public consciousness about what is right and what is wrong. So these are some things that we know that they do. What we don't know, what is claimed but not necessarily proven, is this thing that I was talking about beforehand, that their power actually results from the norm formation of public pressure. There's a correlation. They're exercising public pressure, and we see power and we see change. And so we assume there's a causal link, but that causal link is not actually proven. There's the assumption in general that that civil society organizations are acting on behalf of marginalized populations, that the reason that you get involved in activism is because you've got some sort of altruistic interest. You're not there for yourself, you're there for somebody else. And that the result, in part because of these different things, is that civil society-driven accountability and transparency yields a more democratic global governance. So what we don't know, actually, is whether civil society organizations, when they have this influence, who they're really representing. This is one of the things that is not actually often dug into in the literature. It's assumed, because we've got, say, practitioner accounts, and the practitioner accounts say, we were there to speak on behalf of this Brazilian population or this Argentinian population. But nobody, or in many instances, there isn't kind of digging in to find out, to test those claims. And we don't know about whether this correlation between norm promotion and change actually reflects causation. And in particular, when we're thinking about influence, we also don't know about the role of the state. Sometimes the literature gets so excited about the things that civil society organizations do, they forget the fact that the UN Security Council is still there. The board of executive directors is still there. Do those people, you know, quit their jobs and walk home after civil society arrived on the scene? No, they did not. They still have an interest in what's going on, and so kind of what are they doing? And then, of course, you know, kind of bring these pieces together. Is the net effect actually democratization? So these are some things we don't know from the literature. All right. So now we get to probably the most interesting part, which is what I actually found out. So first of all, I want to set up the conceptual framework that we'll use to think about this. So to help you understand why I chose to focus on the things that I focused on at the bank, let me explain to you a little bit about how I conceptualize democracy. So democracy tends to have, there's some research that, and I'm borrowing this from other people, from Dingworth, from Sharp, from Anders Uhlen. Democracy has these multiple components. Input, throughput, and output. There's a disaggregation of democracy. We tend to think of democracy as very intuitive, you know. It's majority rule. The people have a say, whatever. But there are multiple models of democracy, and democracy has multiple pieces. So this is a way of kind of organizing the pieces of democracy. So input is sort of how the citizen voices get into the system, how they get into the policy process. So they include things like participation, whether or not people are able to participate, inclusion, whether or not everybody is able to participate. So is there participation? Is everybody able to participate? Conversely, is there representation? If not everybody's able to participate, are the people who do participate, are they speaking on behalf of the whole? There's also an element of equality latent in this. Do people actually have an equal say in the process? So that's the input side. Then there's throughput, which is accountability and transparency, which basically has to do with how do these voices get channeled into and used in the policy process. So kind of do things stay on track? And accountability and transparency are the big elements in throughput. And then output is actually the citizen control and majority rule. Kind of are the end results of the process reflective of what the inputs were? Are they actually reflective of 51% of the people who were involved in the process? Were the people that you thought were most important within the process? Or are they reflective of a consensus of the people that were involved? So these are some questions. So you've got input, throughput, and output. And one of the things that I would flag to you is that most of the research that argues for the democratizing power of civil society actually focuses on testing throughput, whether or not civil society produces accountability and transparency. And I would argue that that's actually the least important part of the democratic equation. That if you think about the way that we judge, say, democratic processes in many countries, the things that we ask about are, is there open voting? Can anybody register to vote? Are the votes tallied accurately? And then we ask, well, after the president is voted out of office, does he actually leave office or does he use the army to stay on as a dictator? After the majority of people vote for a certain referendum, does the government actually act on that? Those are the things that we tend to worry about more than the transparency or accountability. The transparency and accountability tend to be sort of the icing on the cake. But input and output are actually the things that we tend to use when we're judging democracy, at least in a government context. So there's a little bit of a disjuncture between how we talk about democracy when we're talking about civil society organizations and how we talk about it in other contexts. And I'm not sure that disjuncture should exist. So one of the things that I do in my research is I try to use a fairly intuitive majoritarian definition of democracy, where basically we judge majoritarian democracy to be occurring when there's equality and inclusion of all citizens or stakeholders, even if it's via a representative. Basically, if you have the effective equivalent of one person, one vote, if everybody's voice is essentially equal in the process, even if it's intermediated by a representative. And then if that inclusion results in citizen control over the government, basically if the government actually is responsive to what the majority of citizens tell them. And so these things lead me in my research to a focus on representation and citizen control. I'm not actually as concerned about transparency or whether organizations are holding actors accountable. I'm interested in this representation and citizen control. Like Tusco was saying, I do research on NGO accountability, but I'm interested in whether or not the NGOs are accountable to represent the citizens rather than the sorts of accountability that they are forcing on other people. So with that in mind, these are some research questions. Who do transnational civil society organizations represent, and how do they impact the equality of representation? How do the organizations achieve their influence? And then kind of pulling those pieces together, is the result improved democratization? So we'll talk about each of these pieces in turn. To give you an idea of the methodology, excuse me, some allergies. Actually, let me just pause there and say, any questions about this? Any questions about where we're going? Yes?
One question I had is, so is the question of representation really the right one? Mm. You know, someone like John Clark, who, as you know, was the former head of the of civil society in the World Bank, he was my first boss there, he argues in his book later, and my students read a chapter from that book, that representation is not the right criteria to judge. Mm-hmm. And he also says, and I think in that sense rightfully, the most sophisticated agencies do not claim to represent particular constituency. Mm-hmm. And so John Clark says, as long as they provide both credible source of technical expertise, as long as they point to local level constituencies that are arguing for the same things that, that they are arguing for, as long as they don't make that they make claims that are based in evidence, representation to him no longer compared to when he started his work is the crucial question. How would you respond to that?
Yeah, so I haven't read the book that you're referring to, but I've read some of his slightly earlier work, and if I'm not misjudging him terribly, I perceive that part of his perspective is that civil society organizations have proliferated to such an extent that it's essentially kind of an open market. You don't have to worry about a big organization speaking for everybody. Instead, if an organization's not speaking for you, if not speaking for you as an individual, some other organization is going to step in to fill that gap because they want your donor dollars or they want your signature on the petition. And so ultimately, everybody will get represented in sort of a free market fashion. And so you don't have to worry about the representativity of individual organizations. Instead, you worry about the representativity of the community as a whole. And he feels like that's going to be self-policing. Essentially, it's going to take care of itself over time. And I feel like in the long term, that may be true. We were talking earlier today about middle-income countries and organizations that step up from middle-income countries and are entering into the advocacy realm. But I feel like in the short term, there are many organizations that lack the resources to participate. You don't actually have equal participation. And so until you have equal participation, you do have to worry about how representative are the people who do get to be involved. That's where I'd come to it. other questions? All right. So these are the research questions. I think it's important to take a minute or two to tell you about my methodology and research approach before we actually get into the findings. So when I was approaching this research, what I found was that much of the work that had been done on transnational advocacy campaigns used what I would call sort of a victory backwards approach. So we find a camp, first of all, people were very interested in showing that civil society organizations could be effective. So they focused on the campaigns that won. And so you find the group of people that win, and then you ask that group of winners, tell us how you got started. And so you end up with essentially what's sort of a victor's history of the campaign. So maybe you've got 10 NGOs that stayed the course, and they're there at the end. And so you ask them about how they got started, and they tell you, all the way back to their concerns, in the village or the origins of their network or whatever it was. And the thing that they neglect to leave out is that when they first got started, there were 30 NGOs that were interested. And five of those didn't favor this particular solution, and so they got marginalized in the meetings. And there were another five that had a leadership dispute, and so they got left out later. And then there were 10 that ran out of money once the lobbying moved to the international realm. And so you've only got these 10 NGOs that are there at the end. And so there, you end up with, as I was saying, sort of a victor's history when looking at advocacy campaigns. It's a selection bias, to use the social science term, in terms of the data. And I wanted to avoid that in my research. And so I tried to use an ontological approach, or an origins forward approach, where I tried to identify campaigns from their initiation and looked at who were all the people that were involved at the beginning of the campaign, what were their views at the beginning of the campaign, and then I could look forward to the end of the campaign and say, well, which of those views were the ones that actually won out? And so one of the things that this started to point me to were conflicts and tensions that existed within civil society and the ways that those get played out in global governance. And I was able to include organizations that quit or were unsuccessful, and I used essentially a process tracing approach, moving forward, looking at each step in the advocacy process. I did this, as I mentioned, looking at the World Bank, and I did this through a series of qualitative case studies. I began with the 10th replenishment of the International Development Association. So the IDA is a part of the World Bank that deals in particular with developing to very poor countries. Because they lend to very poor countries, their lending is essentially unprofitable, and so they need new infusions of cash every 3 years. There's negotiations that surround those infusions of cash, and oftentimes those are times when outside actors try to leverage those negotiations to make changes at the World Bank. So the 10th IDEA happened in the early 1990s, and it was, I would argue that it is the first truly global civil society effort to lobby the bank. There were some other lobbying efforts that occurred earlier, but the IDEA actually had people from all six inhabited continents and really massive coalitions, and massive, I mean, for the time, I mean, we're talking about, you know, 40, 50 NGOs. And some very concrete impacts. And so I took this as sort of like the genesis of truly transnational lobbying of the bank. Generated some hypotheses looking at this very rich case study that I then tested in two subsequent case studies. The first was the Aaron 3 Dam, which is another lobbying effort that was immediately after the IDA 10, so looking at whether the initial patterns that were established there were carried forward. And then looking 15 years later at this fairly technical issue of the use of country systems for procurement, and again, looking to see whether the patterns were carried forward. So basically some hypothesis testing, or hypothesis generation, followed by hypothesis testing, and found that my hypotheses were generally supported, and we'll explain those in a minute. This involved a lot of archival research and document and media analysis, a lot of interviews, some participant observation of live meetings for the use of country systems for procurement. So mixed qualitative methods. And as I was saying, this hypothesis generation and testing. Right. So here's some things that I found. So I said, you know, the questions that we're interested in are first representation, then mechanisms of influence, then pulling those pieces together, looking at the democratization of global governance. So the first thing that I found when I was looking at transnational at representation is that I started to ask organizations and look at their documents and say, how is it that you actually decided to lobby on this issue and choose the position that you chose? Because this gets to the question that you were raising. I'm sorry, I don't know your name.
Rebecca.
That Rebecca was raising regarding, you know, is it problematic that you've got these, you know, wealthy, powerful organizations doing all of the talking? And to get at that, my question is, well, let me find out how it is that you actually decided what you would lobby on. And what I found rather strikingly was that much of the agenda setting happened on the basis not the consultations that were happening with grassroots stakeholders, even though those consultations often occurred, but rather on the basis of pre-existing missions or ideals. That you had organizations that were doing grassroots consultations, but somehow the results of those consultations always aligned with the same mission that they'd been pursuing for the 5 years before they had that consultation. There's really this element of pre-existing mission or ideals, and I've done some follow-on research on this that was more quantitative, where we looked at NGO websites and norms and standards and evidence for meeting norms and standards. And have found this hypothesis to be true not just with the organizations lobbying the World Bank, but with a much broader swath of organizations, that the pre-existing mission or ideals tends to be quite crucial. So that's kind of how you decide what to lobby on, or kind of what you're interested in, I should say. But then there's the question of, and this is the thing that I was saying, that basically the representation is not always the core ideal. Oftentimes, the ideal is something else. The ideal is saving the environment. The ideal is social justice. It's not always actually speaking for a particular group of stakeholders. And what we think of as quote-unquote representation is often actually a matchmaking process. And this is an idea that, honestly, I is not original to me. Clifford Bob is probably the person who really has done the most to popularize this idea with his book, The Marketing of Rebellion. But basically, it's that organizations that have a mission or an ideal go looking for local partners that are aligned with that mission or ideal. And there's even the possibility, and this is a piece that I have that's forthcoming in Global Networks, that what we think of as boomerang activism, if you're familiar with Keck and Seeking's work, that groups in the Global South that are stymied in their efforts to achieve policy change reach out to folks in the Global North, and then the campaign, kind of new global campaign, rebound to the Global South, that boomerang process can actually be inverted. And I saw some of this in lobbying of the World Bank, where basically you have a northern NGO that tries to lobby the World Bank, and the World Bank says, you know, look, you're a bunch of guys with an office in DuPont Circle. Why are we going to change our policy towards Brazil because of you? And so you go looking for some Brazilian NGOs, and then you come back to the World Bank and you say, hey, we've got a global campaign now, because look at all of these NGOs from Brazil and Chile and Argentina who have signed on to our campaign, and now they give you a hearing, and now they listen to the things that you have to say. And so there's this possibility to have sort of inverse boomerang activism. So this is kind of about the choice of mission and the interaction with local stakeholders. But there's this additional element, which is resource constraints. So you may be genuinely interested in an issue. You may even be genuinely interested in representing somebody on that issue. But whether or not that interest translates into activism is dependent upon whether or not you can pay for it. And that's something I think is really quite often overlooked. You know, we think about people who are altruistic, we think about voluntary organizations, but actually advocacy costs money, and effective advocacy, I think, costs a lot of money. Staffing an office in DC for years and building up a network of contacts, that's not an easy thing to do. And most organizations are resource constrained. And as a result, what I found is that civil society organizations are most likely to undertake advocacy if they believe that there's some sort of financial reward. Either it's something that their individual donors expect of them, it's something that they are going to be kind of marketing to their donor base, or even they get kind of particular funding for that advocacy campaign. One of the things that I found very strikingly was that the five largest organizations that were pushing it's not quite an anti-development agenda, but sort of like an anti-big aid agenda with the World Bank, or pushing for very radical reform at the World Bank, had all gotten funding from the same organization. They'd all gotten funding from Charles Stewart Mott. And Charles Stewart Mott had chosen this agenda fairly strategically. They had said, we want to push a global environmental agenda. They went looking for organizations. These five organizations, you know, they aligned with their donor. It's not mercenary behavior. There's genuine alignment. But as a result, there was some very powerful lobbying going on, and that powerful lobbying was all facilitated, or was facilitated in part, by a single fairly prominent donor. And so there's this behind the scenes kind of economic dimension to advocacy and even to big advocacy campaigns that needs to be considered. And there's some additional follow-on research that we've done here that suggests that the choice of targets, whether or not you choose to lobby the World Bank or choose to lobby somebody else, reflects sort of a cost-benefit analysis for your organization, whether or not you think the outcomes of that advocacy are going to be worth the sort of money that you have to put into it. So these are all things that NGOs consider. And these things feed into the representativity of the advocacy agenda. We're not sure who you're actually speaking for because of the things on the previous slide here, right? We're not sure who you're actually speaking for, and then whether or not, but even if you were speaking for the right people, that's a normative term, but even if you were speaking for marginalized populations, whether or not you actually get to the table is determined in part by what the financial situation looks like. These are important considerations. All right. Next, we've got the question of influence. Actually, let me even just pause here. Questions about this? All right. So that's representation. Now we've got these mechanisms of influence, right? How do civil society organizations achieve their influence? It's a question of norms and levers. So the question is, if you don't necessarily have massive public backing, if you're not necessarily speaking for some massive global public, because we've already kind of cast that into doubt in the previous slides, then why is it that policymakers are so receptive to the things that you have to say, right? Yes, my research indicated that at least in this lobbying of the World Bank, yes, there's norm promotion and public advocacy going on, and yes, it's correlated with policy change. But there's a confounding variable, which is that there's something else going on, which is that at the same time you're doing this public advocacy and norm promotion, you're also doing a lot of sort of backroom political lobbying. You're trying to get the United States government to curtail World Bank funding. You're using these other levers. And so then the question becomes, which levers are most effective? And then at the same time, this is where we bring the state back in. And we note that states are retaining significant control. So what's the role of the state in this power equation? So what I found, actually, with civil society organizations and the World Bank is that effective power comes primarily via state allies, that it wasn't the norm promotion that was making civil society organizations effective. It was when they were able to get state legislators or other state policymakers to lobby the bank on their behalf. And as you can imagine, some states, much more influential than others. Um, And state power in particular was exercised by financial leverage. So if your state was a big donor to the World Bank and you could get state policymakers on your side, then you would have much more effective influence over the World Bank. And there's another piece that I've written with Anders Uhlen where we talk about the state channel of NGO influence. And we compare NGOs working directly via the organization versus NGOs working indirectly via the state. And this kind of builds on these findings. So the issue, of course, as we were saying, is that not all states are equal, and not all NGOs, or sorry, civil society organizations, not all TCSOs, are equally able to access state power. So you're really only able to access state power if you've got the appropriate connections and domestic political influence. So the civil society organization that's based in the United States with 3 million members, all of whom are going to go vote in the next election, are going to get policymakers in the United States on their side much more quickly than a non-US-based organization that has no influence over US elections. So there's, again, this disequilibrium in power between civil society organizations. And even more interestingly, what I found is again, going back to, sorry, remind me of your name again.
Rebecca,
thank you. Going back to Rebecca's question, was, you know, again, well, okay, some organizations have more power than others. That's not necessarily a problem. The question is, how do they use their power? And what I found was that at really remarkable records, I ended up getting some documents in which civil society organizations were negotiating with a particular representative who was going to be running the hearings. And they're negotiating, they're going to have some pre-planning meetings with the representative regarding who would be at those meetings. And the representative actually chose one organization, asked them to assemble the guest list. And what was interesting is to watch that guest list evolve. And there was a particular point in which one of the major NGOs broke ranks and said, we're not going to take the critical position the rest of you are taking. And then they get dropped off the guest list. And so there's this gatekeeping function where, and I mean, I also confirmed that in interviews. It wasn't just sort of a random typo kind of thing. There's this gatekeeping function where the powerful organizations actually would work to exclude voices that disagreed with their pre-existing mission, right? So the consequence is that the outcomes disproportionately reflect the views of the politically connected CSOs from powerful states, right? So so the mechanisms of influence are fairly narrow, and they are accessible to a fairly limited group of actors. And those actors are not necessarily seeking to use them in a way that disperses power broadly. Right. So summary. Some groups are represented. The civil society organizations, they are genuinely speaking for somebody. Even if the somebody they're speaking for is even just sort of like their own staff or a limited group of donors. But their choice of cause tends to be determined by these sorts of internal standards. The decision to campaign is financially influenced, and the choice of target may be financially influenced. These are all things that we found out about representation. And then influence is exercised largely via states, and wealthy, powerful states tend to be the most important. Okay. So what then do we think about democracy? Well, we were talking about these questions of inputs and outputs. Civil society organizations have power. That's true. So they do increase citizen control over outputs. So part of the democratic equation is outputs. They do increase citizen control over outputs. But there's no evidence that they actually improve the equality of voice or equality of input into the process. There's no evidence that they're actually seeking to represent people, that they are broadening the base of influence. Instead, there's some evidence that they are furthering the power imbalance, because you have a wealthy population, say based in the United States, that already has disproportionate say because we've got the most powerful executive director at the World Bank, and because the United States appoints the president for the World Bank. And then we have the most powerful civil society organizations that give us sort of a second bite of the apple and allow US voters or US citizens to influence the bank sort of twice over. So rather than making things more even, they actually might be making things worse. And the imbalances are rooted in these systemic factors. It's not that transnational civil society organizations are bad guys or they're not doing the consultations that they should be doing. It's that there are these systemic issues that basically funding creates constraints and establishes incentives. If funding is scarce, why should you share your funding by collaborating with other people or kind of broadening the group of people involved? And if you can achieve influence, alone or in small groups, why should you try to get broader input? I mean, if you're a powerful US-based organization and you can get your agenda through without having to negotiate or compromise with a broader community of NGOs, why do it? You can get the thing that you think is important, that you think is right, and that will be pleasing to your donor base. Why not? I mean, it makes a lot of sense from an organizational standpoint. So I think these things are systemic issues. I'm not saying that the organizations involved were bad organizations or maliciously. The people involved genuinely believed that they were doing the right thing. They were very well motivated. But I think that there are systemic factors in place that influence the outcomes. Right. So let me pause there. Any questions about this so far? Otherwise, we'll just go briefly over some possible solutions.
Yeah.
So I didn't come across any gongos in the research that I was doing. So I'm familiar with the term, but can't speak really to their effectiveness in that regard. I mean, I can say that I think that the closer the relationship between a civil society organization and a powerful government, the more likely they are to be effective. So I'd hypothesize that they might be very effective, but I don't have any empirical data. I haven't looked at it. I haven't looked at it. I confess a degree of skepticism about the process, in part because the question is not so much where your office is located, it's who works in the office. Even if you're hiring more local staff, there's a piece that Janart Schulte published a couple years ago on the IMF's consultations with local civil society. And what he argued is that, yes, the IMF involves lots of civil society, but they always involve civil society that looks kind of strikingly like civil society in the global north. So you go to, if you look at who they're consulting with, they're going to consult with people who are highly educated, who speak English or French, who live in urban areas, who have above average income, and who tend to be men. And so, yes, you have some grassroots consultation, but you don't necessarily have representation, perhaps. It's better than it was. Let me concede that. It is better than it was, but it's still not where we are hoping it would be or where the claims might lead you to think it is, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Let me just follow up on that. Mm-hmm. Centers to other locations outside the what used to be called the West, potentially significant, but maybe not in practice, is the fact that a number of these large confederated, federated organizations are seeking many more national members from South and East, right? And they're in the middle of doing that. As well as the fact that some organizations, more than others, are changing the faces. They're no longer white. Primarily male faces. And ActionAid, for instance, to my mind, is a positive outlier in that regard, in relative terms. So do you think that has an influence on this over time? Because internally, their discourse is that this is meant to change the power dynamics internally within those big families.
Yeah, I think that's exactly the way that things probably need to go. And I think that there can be real change there. I'm not familiar with the ActionAid example, but as I mentioned in your class yesterday, I'm familiar a bit with Brian Doherty's work on Friends of the Earth International. And basically, Friends of the Earth International, they only have, I think, one or two chapters per country. It's limited in some way. And what they did several years ago is they decided that each chapter would get essentially one vote in determining the global agenda for Friends of the Earth International. And there were, of course, more chapters from Global South countries than there were from Global North. And so you ended up with a global agenda that was much more kind of Marxist liberation influenced than you would expect kind of a Western, Northern, American, European agenda to look like. And then the American and European NGOs were constrained to abide by that agenda. Now, they did have sort of a consensus-driven process. It wasn't just sort of a coup by the developing country NGOs. But I think that, yes, there are some right now, outliers, but there are some NGOs that are definitely pointing the way on that.
If I can just respond to what you said, I think it's really interesting what you just said a little bit earlier in response to my first question. Mm-hmm. It's also linked to representation in those national chapters. Mm-hmm. So the people you're picking mm-hmm. to lead the national chapters of ActionAid, Amnesty, Oxfam, mm-hmm. and they all have that method of governance which you've just described, where one country, one vote.
Yeah.
So in the international governance structure of Amnesty, Oxfam, and ActionAid was always a federation. So regardless of whether you were Malawi or the United Kingdom, which is the largest fundraising body, mm-hmm. you still had one vote. So mm-hmm. it did not matter how much money you raised, which is mm-hmm. the process that Oxfam is now going to go through. But ultimately, if the person leading the Malawi chapter mm-hmm. has the exact same profile mm-hmm. in terms of being educated, urban, very westernly oriented Marxist views, and I apologize for using that term, but there's Marxists and then there are other Marxists. So if in the same room the people from the north and from the northern south are saying the exact same thing, I think intuitively the first question you should ask is, what's wrong in that group? So in a lot of cases, from what I have seen, it has become an issue of representation within the southern chapters. Like, you're not getting, as you mentioned, the voices of the marginalized. You're getting still the people who are the elites within that nation. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yeah. So. I love this idea of agreement as a litmus test for dysfunction. I think that you should write an article about that. You know? So yes, it makes a lot of sense. All right. Any other questions? I'll present a few solutions here. Those are great questions and input. So then, reforming civil society's representation of stakeholders. So the needed reform, I think, is improving equality of input, making sure that actually everybody's voice is treated in an equal way. That it's not that you tend to have influence because you're lucky enough to be born in a wealthy, powerful state. A second need or related need is to verify representative claims and to encourage direct accountability between NGOs and the people they claim to represent. So it shouldn't be enough that, you know, your organization goes shopping in the developing world for somebody who agrees with you and will sign on to your global agenda. There should be some means of verifying that when you come to the bank as an American or European NGO and say, we've got 25 global partners, there should be some means of verifying that those global partners, just as you were saying, are in fact representative of the countries that they're coming from. So exactly the problem that you're raising. So there needs to be some means of doing that. And I would suggest that I think that systemic solutions are possible. Now, I've had some debates with colleagues as to whether or not this is naive, so take it with a grain of salt. But I think that systemic solutions are possible, in part because of the fact that TCSOs do, in fact, respond to market stimuli. So the fact that they are economically sensitive, I think, means that you can use the market to change behavior. That's my idea. So basically, at the World Bank, I think that you should seek to test how representative civil society organizations are, rather than taking their claims of representation at face value. So if people say that we are here to speak on behalf of the population of India, you should ask, well, how do you prove that you actually speak on behalf of that group? And I think that what you can do is you can use fundraising as a fairly crude but effective litmus test. So basically, how many people from India are paying to support your organization? Now, that may seem improbable at some level, because we think, oh, this advocacy is so expensive. But If you've done work in the developing world, the thing that you know is that actually there's all sorts of grassroots civil society in developing countries. There are rural farmers collectives, and there are women's savings collectives. And these groups have hundreds and thousands of members. Now, they may be paying the equivalent of 25 cents a month to participate, but they are paying to participate. And so what I would like to see in particular is that for organizations, I mean, and the bank is great at finding these organizations when they have to run a development project. So why can't they be great at finding these organizations when they have to do a policy consultation? So rather than taking the organization that steps up and says, we've got some policy knowledge, and we can put somebody on a plane to DC, ask that organization, well, who's funding you? And if it turns out, well, actually our partner NGO in New York is funding us, they're off the list. And if you strike all of those organizations from the list, maybe then you have to go looking. And you have to find the farmers collective in the area where the dam is going to be built, or the women's the women's savings collective where you want to do the gender project, and fly those people to DC, because those are the people that actually can demonstrate grassroots support on the basis of the funding of their organization. So it's a crude measure. Money's not everything. But it's I like to think that it's better than what we've got right now, maybe a first step. This is this idea of requiring demonstration of representation of a stakeholder population. And then also kind of within these dialogues, if you can kind of set up essentially kind of a quota system. So you're an organization that's from the United States, and you say, we want to come participate in the dialogue. Well, who funds you? Well, actually, people in New Jersey fund us. OK, great. You can come and speak for the people in New Jersey. But actually, we need to make sure that we have some people from Malawi who are also at the table. So we go looking for somebody who's going to speak for the people in Malawi. The US NGO says, we can speak for Malawi. Well, who funds you again? New Jersey. OK, you speak for New Jersey. Let's go find some people who get funded in Malawi. And we bring them to the table. So you actually kind of set aside seats at the table for people who can demonstrate their representativity, and you make sure that the seats are actually distributed in proportion or in relation to the impacts of the project. Okay? And I think that this actually might incentivize transnational civil society organizations towards these more democratic reforms because they don't want to be excluded. So insofar as we're seeing these things happen with Friends of the Earth or ActionAid, those sorts of reforms might be sped along by creating new incentives within the system. And then I think that civil society organizations perhaps need to do more to embrace a norm of representativity, if this is possible, and this is other research that I'm doing. But I think that one of the things that you could do is, you were saying this thing earlier about kind of bringing people to the table rather than speaking for them. And I think that, for instance, if civil society organizations in privileged countries or that have additional resources worried less about speaking on behalf of others and more focused more on facilitating others speaking for themselves, I think that that's a possibility. So we're not going to speak for the people in Malawi. We are going to send some plane tickets to Malawi. And particularly if you have organizations that maybe pool their resources under some sort of maybe neutral administrator, I think that there's some possibility. And NGOs are already doing lots of coordination with things like with these various kind of peer networks like HAP and Sphere, if you're familiar with those. So I don't think this is too far-fetched. I think this is possible. All right. So these are my solutions. So I'll stop there because I know that we're supposed to have some Q&A time, and I'm not really sure how we've done on the time. But so I'll stop there and see what sorts of questions, some final questions.
Because you invited questions at several points. We're doing OK. So we have 20 minutes left. Oh, your funding comes from New Jersey, so you can't speak. You can only speak from New Jersey. So what's up? I belong to an organization in Medellin. I'm speaking for that organization, but our funding comes from Washington, so are we automatically disqualified because of that, or is it more of organizations in the U.S. that have that thing and say, oh, we're working in Columbia, and it just said they're
Yeah, so I mean, like I said, it's a crude measure because the money doesn't, getting money from Washington doesn't mean that you're getting it wrong when you're speaking for people in Colombia. But what I would say is it means that your accountability is to Washington, not to Colombia, in the sense that if you say something that displeases lots of Colombians, you don't lose your funding and you don't lose your job. If you say something that really displeases the people in Washington, you might lose your funding and you might lose your job. So there isn't any check to ensure that you're speaking on behalf of the people in Colombia. So yes, would a funding litmus test potentially exclude some great organizations that happen to get funding from overseas? Yes, that is a risk. But do I think that it might be a step forward? I think so. I mean, maybe one question to think about it this way is, if your organization knew that in order to participate in a dialogue, you actually had to be able to demonstrate a sort of paying Colombian membership base, would it incentivize your organization to do more grassroots outreach?
The problem with that basically is that places like Colombia have very little cultural participation in NGOs and things like that. Like, you go to any American household, you will find the picture of the African child in their refrigerator and say, oh, I donate to that, right? In Colombia, that doesn't happen. Charity work is basically the ladies of the Red Cross with the little money banks in the supermarket. It's not huge. Mm-hmm. So we don't have that. Like, there's no possibility of finding enough funding for us to do our work. So it'll automatically be excluding a lot of the big NGOs that are actually doing a lot of the good work but can't find local funding. And if you see other cases in Africa, for example, just there's not enough money. Like, how are you going to get the money to actually do your work?
Well, I can't speak to the Latin American context, but I can speak to the African context. And I would say in Africa there are very large indigenous NGOs. They're not NGOs as you might think of them in the sense of having computers and offices and fax machines. But I mean, there are farmers' collectives in probably every village. There are women's societies in every village, and these groups do have local funding, even if the funding is at very marginal levels. So are there challenges in involving those sorts of groups? Yes. I mean, would the bank have to essentially fund their participation? Yes. Does that put the bank kind of in sort of an awkward position of choosing who they talk to? And does that open them up for criticism? Yes. But is there at least some sort of tangible connection between those organizations and the people that they're claiming to speak for? Well, yeah, there's that too. So they're... it's a trade-off. It's not a perfect solution. And I think that you're highlighting very well part of the problem, the reason that it's not a perfect solution.
On exactly this topic of local accountability, I really am dubious about your reliance on the finances and whether or not you get your financial support locally. I really think there's a lot of other accountability mechanisms. I don't know Colombia. I do know that lots of people have been shot in Colombia. Mm-hmm. Now, that's not the same as losing your job. Mm-hmm. And that is certainly not something that you can trace on the balance sheets, mm-hmm. right? It is not about financial support for Colombia. But it is, I think, a legitimate, very closely felt level of accountability. And I think that when anyone speaks for certain organizations in Colombia, if they live to tell it again, you can be pretty certain that they haven't displeased certain people in Colombia. I'm bolstering your objection. I really don't know that that's the only way to go with this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, maybe I see there's some other hands here, so maybe I won't respond to that right now. I mean, we could talk about that a little bit more.
It's your choice. Would you like to respond to that first before?
Well, sure. Okay, I'll respond to that. The challenge that I have in what you're saying is that if I understand you literally, the accountability that's being exercised in Colombia is actually being exercised by violence.
Yes. But in certain cases, not in every human rights case.
Basically, yes.
Yeah, human rights
it's plain. It's by self-sacrifice.
It's literally plain and simple.
That's the
right. So, but I think there's a tension here. So the fact that people are risking their lives signals that they are very dedicated, and that they believe very passionately in the things that they are doing. but that does not signal that they are representative of the population whom they on whose behalf they are working. They're simply two different things. If you're saying that the fact that they don't get shot demonstrates that they are speaking on behalf of the general population.
I was very clear about certain people, the ones with the guns are shooting.
Yeah, right. So I'm just saying that the fact that you are risking your life, which I don't mean to denigrate in any way, but the fact that people are risking their lives demonstrates something about themselves and what they believe, but it doesn't demonstrate anything about what the general population believes. But I mean, does Colombia not have churches that are supported by local donations?
Definitely, but that's what it is. If a Colombia wants to give charity, it won't give it to an NGO, it will give it to the church. So are we gonna just like fill the room with the Catholic priests? Because that's what that's what it's implying. They're the only ones getting the money.
Mm-hmm.
And the problem is what she's saying and what I'm getting at is like, mm-hmm. NGOs have sort of like a terrible reputation with a lot of the private sector.
Mm-hmm.
So most companies, most private big businesses will not give to the NGOs because they feel they're leftist,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Mm-hmm.
And so whether the NGO is or not is mm-hmm. a leftist NGO or whatever, they won't give them money.
So you can come up with one indicator of mm-hmm. legitimacy of representativity, which is what we're pushing you to mm-hmm. consider.
Yes.
Any one measure of... Mm-hmm.
Well, you certainly could do things like this, the thing that's going on to say like Friends of the Earth International, which, and I understand ActionAid, where you develop kind of new voting structures or other means of accountability to the grassroots. So I think that funding is sort of a quick litmus test. But is it possible to have other sorts of organizational reform that generate grassroots accountability? Absolutely. Yes.
Okay, let's hear some other voices. Yeah.
I was going to say, you know, it seems like it's putting the World Bank in a position to really be choosing who it's going to talk to,
mm-hmm.
which I think anyone who is involved with, you know, civil society organizations doesn't want to see that restriction.
Mm-hmm.
And sure, you know, there might be an exclusive sort of system going on within these organizations, but, I mean, it seems like that would be more sort of, in a sense, like open and democratic as opposed to putting the World Bank in a position to say, well, we're going to, you know, use this criteria to judge whether or not we're going to talk to it.
Mm-hmm.
Then there's the issue of representation. I mean, it's great, you know, we want organizations that are representative of populations.
Mm-hmm.
Sure, but what does representation mean? I mean, organizations are working on issues that often are unpopular.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't mean they're illegitimate issues.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, any topic you can look back at was never necessarily in the majority consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it is about trying to change minds and effectuate, you know, behavioral change in people too.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, by nature, they do start out, you know, often just being unpopular or in a dangerous situation or something of that nature. That doesn't mean that they don't
mm-hmm.
have a legitimate issue that they're working on, that they shouldn't have some
mm-hmm.
sort of a seat at the table.
Well, and I think that's probably a place where you and I would simply just disagree. And it's not that... I fully agree with you that oftentimes we've got things that are unpopular causes that eventually work their way into the mainstream. But my question here is not about... What's that?
Probably all causes.
We discussed the history of that. But yes, let's just say for the sake of argument, all causes. But my question here is not one of social justice, but rather one of democracy. So my issue is not how is it that we lead the change. My issue is, you know, in terms of making the bank, say, more socially progressive, my question is simply, how do we make sure that the bank is accountable for the norms that are the interests that exist currently? Making the bank socially progressive is probably another step past that. So I think that we probably just have different interests. And so my interest, or kind of my objective, is one of democratic representation, which does mean that sometimes groups that are unpopular because they are on the leading edge of some element of some sort of, on some particular issue, may not make it to the table. Yes?
Good question. I don't know if it was part of your research or not. Did you come across, like, in the activities of the, let's say, World Bank, what kind of groups of civil society organizations were less represented for, like, you know, minority groups? I'd say, like, some different civil society organizations work on specific areas, mm-hmm. like LGBT issues or women's issues mm-hmm. or financial issues and disability issues. And my interest is mostly the disability. So did you come across anything about, like, you know, which minority groups are less represented in World Bank? I know World Bank has what they call it, guardianship.
Mm-hmm.
Their policy has mm-hmm. to ensure that they all programs are inclusive.
Uh-huh. So my experience, not with this research, but with some earlier research, is that it had less to do with the issue area in which organizations worked, and more to do with their technical expertise. So I mean, there are two things going on. So when you are lobbying via states, it didn't really matter what your particular area of interest was. What mattered was sort of the size of your supporter base. So that's one thing. So again, issue area didn't matter. At the bank itself, if you're using a direct approach to the bank, a lot of the power is wielded essentially kind of at the middle level, the sort of like task team leader level, people who are running a particular project. And if you can make yourself valuable to those people because you have technical expertise and you can make their project run smoother, run better, bring them new ideas when they need new ideas, then they are willing to listen to you. And if you don't have technical expertise that you can bring to the table, then there isn't a lot of value for them in listening to you. And so it's less to do with the sector in which you operate and more to do with the technical expertise of your organization and what you can bring to the table. That's what I found. Now, limited sample size. I'm not saying that's totally generalizable, but that's what I found.
About this, what these two elements of democracy, also transparency and accountability, and later you said about how you think, and I agree with you, that they're ultimately not the most important indicators. But I will say some of the ironies that one goes to when you either work in the World Bank or when you later study it. For instance, on the issue of transparency, you may know the work by the Global Accountability Report of some mm-hmm. years ago, multiple years of work. The bank actually scored better, significantly better on transparency towards the general public mm-hmm. globally than NGOs did.
Mm-hmm.
It scored significantly less good on participation, for instance, but mm-hmm. it scored much better on transparency. And then you get a really interesting phenomena where the bank's information policy changed quite radically in the early 90s
mm-hmm.
from all World Bank information is confidential unless we make mm-hmm. it public to the reverse. Everything is public unless we have justified reasons for making it confidential. And what do we find out 10 to 15 years later? That about 60% of World Bank documents that are now all public have never even been opened one time on the bank's website. Not even one time by one
wow.
constituent in the whole world.
Mm-hmm.
So here as a civil society, we pushed and they pushed us, you know, for a long time for total transparency, and then there is no citizen interested in it, which I thought was really funny.
Sad, but funny.
Yes.
Kind of way.
Yeah, funny in a certain kind of way. And the other dilemma that I sometimes observed when I was in the thing, in the World Bank, is that, first of all, if you do citizen consultations
mm-hmm.
as a World Bank official, and again, we were part of this whole contingent of a whole set of social scientists that came into the World Bank in the early to mid 90s to actually with a kind of covert agenda to change the organization
mm-hmm.
from within, right? That was our collective action. And what we found was that in citizens' consultations, as a World Bank actor, as an IGO, you get tons of very contradictory input. Right?
Yeah.
Because the more citizens you listen to, or citizens, the more contradictory input you get. So ultimately, you still have to decide what you're going
to
give credence and or not, and you are balancing a whole set of stakeholders, the
mm-hmm.
way NGOs also have to balance multiple stakeholder perspectives. And the other thing is that as you tried to, as I said yesterday in class, I think, as the bank also tried to kind of just let, in a country setting particularly, or in a region, let civil society decide themselves who should represent whom,
mm-hmm.
so you would get more of the credible local voices, you would get a lot of people at a round table or consultation that would speak with great passion and with great local knowledge, etc. But in a way that for a World Bank official who works at a, I'm not talking about elitism now, but who works at a meta level in terms of number of issues that it has to kind of bring together, was really not very helpful. So it became even more of a tokenistic exercise. Mm-hmm. So there's a real, mm-hmm. there's a real dilemmas there that make this not so clear cut.
Yeah.
Would you acknowledge?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah.
So.
Other last comments, questions?
Yes.
I have one. We don't have to stay for it.
That's all right. You have time. Yeah, we have a few more minutes.
Yeah.
And I think, are you available?
Yes, I'm available for a couple hours. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. I have greatly enjoyed your talk today. Don't mistake my enthusiasm for combativeness.
Oh, no, no. It's totally fine. And you have a totally legitimate grievance regarding the Columbia case.
Oh, absolutely. So. And.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Right. If we were to follow your sort of model of proportionate to the impacts of the project, what we would end up with, I think, is some sort of series of representation whereby, you know, if we've got showing up for all of the people who have HIV, what ends up happening is what ends up happening with the UNAIDS metrics, mm-hmm. which is that suddenly we're paying a lot of attention to really big populations like India and China, where the level of HIV is very, very small, right? Mm. Turns out 1% of India is a lot bigger than 30% of Botswana, mm. right? And so you've got the UN suddenly directing all of its everything to combat HIV away from countries where the epidemic is literally killing the country, right? A third, 25%, you're in Africa, sorry, 25 to 30% of some countries have this terrible disease, mm-hmm. right? We're pulling out all of the resources and putting them into really big places because there are more people. They're not relatively more, mm-hmm. but they're absolutely more. Mm-hmm. And so if we follow that sort of, one voice, one vote, one person, one moment, what ends up happening with this business about majority rule? Mm-hmm. Suddenly we've got people representing themselves on the issues that have a very different relationship to the context that they come from. And I submit to you that we end up doing this thing about majority rule that does not, in fact, get to issues of representativity, which is about proportion and about relationality and sociality, and not just about, oh, let's count up the numbers and think that we've done our job if we're listening to the people that are the majority.
Mm-hmm. I think it's an excellent objection. And honestly, not one that I had thought about very much because I wasn't thinking at that kind of global strategy level. I was kind of assuming once the bank decides to do the project and they're trying to, whatever, develop the relocation strategy or develop the specifics that go into a particular project, they should think about who are the people who are going to be impacted by this project and try to make sure that those are the people who are best represented in
this. Assuming a geographical boundedness there.
Yes, exactly. I'm assuming because to basically avoid the moral hazard problem, that you want the people who are going to be impacted by the policy to be the people who are deciding the policy. But yes, I'm assuming a geographic boundedness. I think that if you are trying to scale this to the global level, which you're right, it was sort of like the logical.
You're saying transnational, and you're still putting these boundaries on it. Like,
right, but I'm just trying to explain, in terms of the bank's processes, I was assuming these sorts of inputs after the bank had already decided a particular strategy or project. And that was maybe latent in my assumptions on this. But you're absolutely right that the logical extension is to make strategic programming also democratic. And if you do that, then you end up with these sorts of issues, which I agree. I mean, we could probably talk for another half an hour about that, because you really get well past issues of democracy and into issues, much more complex normative issues of justice.
Yeah.
Yes, okay. Yes, well, that is true. So yes, we could describe it that way. We would talk about it, it's well past majoritarian democracy and towards other visions, absolutely, yes.
Well, maybe that is a good way to end the official talk then,
yeah.
And engage in some bilaterals.
All right.
Right. So Chris, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, my pleasure.
It was very stimulating and
thank you.
We really enjoyed it.
Thank you.